more than anything else, they remember what it felt like to skate.
The swiftness, the feeling, the freedom. There's a wonderful feeling of gliding on ice.
Lacing up figure skates and stepping out onto that ice served as a woman's declaration of freedom.
Skating backwards fast and having the wind blowing your hair. I don't know, just maybe like flying. You know, you just feel you're free.
The chance to win an Olympic medal by swooping and soaring was almost too impossibly romantic to be true.
Beautiful snow-capped mountains, clear blue sky. I think I was in heaven. I mean, I just loved it.
Ice has a alive feeling, warm velvet, soft.
To be a ladies' figure skater in the first half of this century was to be a lady. To dress a certain way and represent your club or your country with style and grace. But all the style in the world didn't matter if you couldn't skate a straight line or carve out a figure eight. The sport was called figure skating for a reason.
You had to have excellent figures to be allowed to free skate.
It was a drawing. A figure was a drawing. And you were drawing with your blade instead of with your hand.
To be sure, back in those idyllic days of ladies' figure skating, the ice wasn't always so smooth, nor the competition so fair, or the judging so keen.
It was very political back in those days. You put my pair first, I'll put your single first. There was a lot of that going on.
This wasn't a sport as we know it today, but a cross between an athletic endeavor and the Miss America pageant.
I always tried to make it beautiful every time I did it. I wanted everyone to watch me.
Still, nothing could diminish that joy. Eyes sparkling, gloriously dancing, on a pair of freshly sharpened white skates under the winter sun.
There were so many things very different skating outdoors. Sometimes we'd even shovel our own area for practicing school figures.
At the turn of the century, ice skating was a diversion fit for a lady, a socially acceptable way to take the outdoor air. It was a means for men and women to court in public, to be seen holding hands without causing shock. But figure skating, the sport, was purely a male domain. In those days, no one but the rabid suffragettes believed women should even be athletes at all. So imagine the commotion a British housewife named Madge Sayers caused when she arrived with her husband Edgar at the 1902 World Championships in London. Madge hadn't merely come to watch, but to compete against the men.
They were horrified, probably. But then they realized that there was nothing in their rules that prevented a woman from competing with men, so they allowed her to compete. She was not representing equal rights for women particularly. She was representing her own right to compete.
Not only did she compete, she finished second behind Sweden's Ulrik Salchow, who would ultimately win 10 world titles. Only this skating immortal stood between Sayers and the World Championship, which men had been contesting among themselves since 1896.
There is only one world champion, and that's the man, even today. In our rules, we still call women ladies. It's the World Ladies Championship. So there's this concept of the male protecting the female, I suppose. And, Madge kind of broke that by showing she could skate with the men.
4 years later, in 1906, the skating union organized a separate competitive event for ladies. Appropriately, Madge Sayers won this twice. In 1908, in her final competition, Madge underscored her name in the history books by winning the first Olympic gold medal in ladies' figure skating. World War I then intervened, canceling the Olympic Games. Madge Sayers did not live to see her Olympic successor. In 1917, she died in childbirth at the age of 35. Her daughter, Virginia, died as an infant. In 1920, the Olympics encompassed both summer and winter sports. The six-time U.S. champion, Teresa Weld, paid her own way to Belgium to compete. There, she caused some controversy.
She was marked down in her free skating, she says, because she did elements of jumps, simple jumps, we would think of them today, in which her skirt went up. And she was criticized for that. The feeling among the men was that the women should not display their legs.
But if the fashion of the day, long dresses, kept the lady skaters earthbound, it also helped them fight the elements. At the time of the first Winter Olympics in 1924, figure skating was usually contested out of doors. Rinks were shared with hockey players or public sessions or speed skaters. There were still problems in Switzerland 4 years later.
Oh, that was the Olympics in 1928. Because you see, St. Moritz didn't have an artificial skating rink. It was out of doors. And the stadium was impossible to skate on. It had no ice. So we skated at the Kulm Hotel rink. And the whole rink, they couldn't use part of it. They kept as clean as they could, and there were little holes. And so they put flags in. So you had to skate around those flags. The Olympics, you had to skate around those flags. You had to be careful.
Oh, there was no such thing as a Zamboni. I think it was in Davos, just before the competition, the snow people went on strike. So we had to go out earlier and shovel off our own area and then practice.
It was an awful problem, it really was, because, I mean, you had to practice in a snowstorm, you had to practice when it was windy. In Vienna, you'd practice when the rain was falling down, that sort of thing, and that made the ice very, very difficult.
European skaters had an advantage over American skaters. They had access to outdoor rinks, which allowed them to anticipate weather conditions they might encounter in competitions. Americans were referred to as hothouse skaters because they spent all of their time practicing indoors. As competitions approached, they looked for ways to skate out in the elements. In the 1950s, New York City Mayor Robert Wagner heard that Carol Heiss of Queens had talent but needed outdoor ice time. He offered her early morning use of the world-famous rink at Rockefeller Center.
You feel like you're really in a hole. I'd look up and here would be all these people looking down at me, you know, on their way to work. So it wasn't really the most enjoyable kind of training, but at least it gave me an idea of what it was like to skate in the wind. When it would rain, Mr. Bernay would be thrilled. Oh, good, now we can do sections of the program. We can try to fit it in because it's raining. In exchange, it was sort of understood that once in a while, my sister and I would happen to come by Rockefeller Center and we'd give an exhibition for the people shopping.
The Heisses were a family of modest means. The cost of outfitting the three Heiss children for skating lessons were substantial.
Well, nothing was free. We had to pay for everything. Our coach, Mr. Bernay, bought a pair of skates or helped pay for the costume. 20 or 25 minutes is about $6 for your skating lesson, so it would be about $18 an hour. Most people didn't take an hour because they couldn't afford it.
You had to be the champion of the United States in order to get your way paid to world. So if you were second or third place, you had to pay your own way.
A young lady who wanted to be a world-class skater joined a skating club. There she'd train and learn the etiquette of the sport. Skating clubs originated out of the simple interest and joy of having a place to skate. But for most of the century, These clubs maintained an elitist attitude about membership.
Usually these private clubs had a membership committee, and you could be blackballed for any reason, whether you were from a certain ethnic group or your parents weren't in a certain profession. I remember I brought a membership application to my father in which he had to put down how much he made and what he did for a living, and he handed it back to me and he said, "Frank, just forget this. It's none of these people's business what I do or how much money I make."
The New York Skating Club was a very prestigious, kind of snooty club. You know, they didn't want some riffraff young kid. We don't care if she's national champion, you know, in here. But ultimately, there were a few people that got me in.
Only a tiny segment of the population even knew about skating clubs. In 1929, only 15 American skating clubs existed. Although women participated in athletics in the 1920s, sports were a world dominated by men, like Red Grange and Babe Ruth, Bobby Jones and Jack Dempsey. Women could wear their hair bobbed and dance the Charleston, but the thought of a figure skater capturing American hearts would have seemed absurd. And then it happened.
I believe she was hard as nails, but she didn't come across like that.
I tell you something. The first time I ever met Sonia was when she was a little girl and I was a little girl, and she came to Vienna to practice. It was, I think, in 1925. She looked so beautiful. We had all our sailor suit or pleated skirt or whatever. And Sonia had a pink dress, and then she had a blue dress with monkey hair, I still remember. Beautiful.
Whenever she came on the ice, she was always so marvelously dressed, and she never came on in the outfit twice.
Sonia Henny was the paragon of all that her sport had to offer. Impossibly glamorous, impeccably composed, she was a 10-time world champion and 3-time Olympic gold medalist. Matchless achievements.
Miss Henny, are you too tired to say a few words for the newsreels?
Not at all. I'm very pleased. What can I say?
As a 12-year-old competing in her first Olympics in 1924, Sonia was the first to skate in a short dress. She could get away with this because of her youth. The short dress freed Sonia to experiment with jumps. Soon she was doing single axels. These were being done only by men before Sonia. She was the first skater to spice her athleticism with a performer's flair. Her father made certain of that. Papa Henny choreographed every move his daughter made. He was a sports agent decades before his time, a shrewd businessman for his daughter in an era when skaters were strict amateurs and not allowed to be paid under any circumstances.
Oh, Papa Henny. Papa Henny maneuvered everything for Sonia. He's a big man, and he'd always be clapping and doing things.
Papa Henny, my goodness, he was huge. He was rotund, to say the least. Mrs. Henny was a very nice woman, extremely nice. And one could talk to her, but one never spoke to Papa Henny. I mean, Papa was Papa Henny, and that was it.
There was no hype or publicity in those days. But funny enough, he was the exception.
The stories about Papa Henny are infamous. Story about demanding a packard car to take Sonia around in. And although Sonia couldn't accept money, he then turned around and sold the car and pocketed the money. Sort of an indirect way of getting paid for her services when she was an amateur.
I'd have been horrified if my father had done it, because, you know, it just wasn't done.
He produced my Sonia. Here is my Sonia.
But Sonia would have had the skill to succeed even without the promotion. A remarkable athlete, she finished second in the national tennis championships of her native Norway in 1935. That same year, at the age of 23, she won her 9th consecutive world title. Maribel Vinson Owen, the bronze medalist behind Sonia in 1932, respected the Norwegian's athleticism.
Maribel told me that Sonia could probably have been Olympic champion at any sport she chose, that she was a tremendous athlete. had a perfect body for sport and was very, very naturally strong. Sonia's style of skating was very old-fashioned, and we would imitate her and, you know, make fun of her. Maribel would be livid and just say, you know, you have no idea how fast she was, how good her figures were, and what a fabulous skater she was, and so just all of you stop it.
She did what they call a flat foot, one foot spin. And I haven't seen any of the modern skaters do a flat foot spin since Sonia day. They all do it on a toe, which is far easier.
Papa Henny brought his Sonia to the 1927 World Championships in their hometown of Oslo. Austrian Herma Szabo, a five-time world titleist, was defeated by the 14-year-old Sonia.
The reason why Szabo was beaten by Sonia in 27 was very simple. There were five judges and three of them were Norwegians. They just stacked the deck for Sonia in 1927.
From then on, it was Sonia against the world. Herma visited the young Austrian bronze medalist Fritzi Berger, who would be Sonia's rival for the next 5 years. Herma arrived with a gift and a message.
Herma came to my house in Vienna and brought me some tights and a skirt and said, now try to beat her. Didn't help any.
In San Moritz in 1928, Sonia became the youngest Olympic champion at 15. Fritzi finished second.
The Olympic Games are on.
4 years later in Lake Placid, New York, the two met again at the Olympics. Standing room only tickets for the ladies' event were selling for an unheard of sum of $5. Again, Sonia triumphed.
I think I had the hope, against hope really, that maybe one day I could beat her. Maybe one day she break a leg. Maybe one day she has a cold or can't skate or whatever. Never happened. I don't think Sonia ever had a cold in her life.
Sonia was not only the best skater on the ice, she was the most stylish. Her costumes were individually designed by her personal Norwegian tailor. Any potential rival faced not only her superb talent, but her incomparable stage presence, her sophistication, and a daunting history of success.
How many world championships have you won?
I have 9, and if I win this year, it'll be 10 world championships and 3 Olympic Games.
Do you think you will win?
Well, don't ask me those kind of questions.
Competing in Germany in her final Olympics in 1936, Sonia was placed first by 6 judges. But the 7th judge tied Sonia and Cecilia College for first place. Perhaps Cecilia's mother seemed to realize that her 15-year-old daughter stood little chance against the world's best.
I wanted to wear my little green dress. I love my little green satin dress, which I always felt I skated well in, and I would like to have worn that. But I wasn't given a chance. I was told to wear the silver dress, so I wore the silver dress. And that was that. I mean, silver in the afternoon is wrong. I mean, even gold would have been better. But to skate for a gold medal and dress your child in silver seems to me absolutely crazy.
When are you turning professional?
I'm never turning professional. I've always been an amateur, and I want to stay one.
No Olympic athlete embraced professionalism with as much fanfare as Sonia. In 1938, only 2 years after she retired from amateur competition, Sonia became a millionaire. She was 26. Papa Henny died 1 year earlier. He lived only to see the beginning of his daughter's worldwide success.
Miss Henny, it is indeed a pleasure to know that you have accepted this contract to star in 20th Century Fox Pictures, and I have every reason to believe that you will achieve on the screen the same international success that has made you the greatest ice skater and the most popular young lady in the world of sport.
Thank you, Mr. Sadek. I shall do my best.
She earned $125,000 for each of her first 2 films. Then renegotiated her contract to get $300,000 each for the following 8.
Dancing on ice.
Who's afraid of love? What else are we living for? How can anyone ignore?
By the late 30s, Sonia was earning $800,000 annually with the Hollywood Ice Review. She had replaced boxer Jack Dempsey as the world's top sporting attraction. And in 1938, Sonia trailed only Shirley Temple at the American box office.
When I was 10 years old, my then coach, Otto Gold, took me back to her dressing room. And oh, what a thrill to see Sonia standing there in her full show makeup and all her gorgeous costumes hanging on racks in the dressing room. And she was very sweet and gave me a great big autographed picture.
The first time I met her, I was 12 years old. And she looked at me and she said, so you're Carol Heiss. She said, they keep saying you're going to be a second Sonia Henie. She looked at me and she said, honey, I'm afraid there's never going to be another Sonia Henie.
Life in Hollywood meant lavish parties with the biggest celebrities. In a publicity stunt that was also a shrewd business decision, she had her legs insured for $5,000. Before anyone had ever seen a Zamboni, Sonia bought one in 1949. By bringing it on her tour, Sonia helped change the way American ice rinks were maintained. 7 years later, at the age of 44, Sonia retired from skating. Out of the movies, her skating career over, Sonia's public image faded. After four decades in the spotlight, she lived her lavish life in private.
Sonia Henie always wore a bracelet. It said on one side, to Sonia Henie from her best friend. And you turned it over, and it said Sonia Henie.
Henie, I understand this is the first Winter Olympics you've attended since you won the title last in 1936.
That's great. And I'm certainly thrilled to be here today, because it's always just wonderful to be back here.
You know why she came to the Olympics? Because John Harris, of Ice Capades fame, urged her to come. She said, oh, no, no, nobody will know who I am. I walked into the arena with her, and the photographer's flashbulbs were going. And most of their cameras were empty. John Harris had asked his friends to give her a reception that would make sure that she was recognized and well-known, and so they went up flashing her picture, and she felt as though she was remembered and was very happy.
Sonia had stopped skating entirely for nearly a decade, but in 1964, at the age of 53, she had secret thoughts of a comeback.
One morning, I was taking my skates off, and all of a sudden, this midnight blue Rolls Royce pulled up, and out came this woman with two Norwegian elk hounds on a leash. She had on a yellow leotard with a yellow chiffon scarf around her neck, and this humongous yellow canary diamond on one hand, everything matching, the diamond, the scarf, the leotard. And it was Sonia. When she walked into the rink and stepped out of that car, you knew you were in the presence of a star.
In 1968, Sonia was diagnosed with leukemia. Her third husband, Niels Onstad, never gave her the final diagnosis. On October 12, 1969, Sonia died sleeping in her husband's arms aboard a private plane. A life filled with such public accomplishments ended in private and in peace. Sonia Henie could have made headlines as a ballerina, a tennis champion. She chose skating, and the world will never forget.
She may look sweet and gentle and nice, but underneath, she's granite and nails.
Seeing Sonia Henie in the movies, reading about Barbara Ann Scott in Life magazine, or watching Peggy Fleming on a grainy telecast all the way from France, a young girl could easily reach the conclusion that her skating heroes lived impossibly glamorous lives. In reality, the few who achieved fame in the sport did it by dedicating their childhoods to training in cold ice rinks, mostly in obscurity. One move that every female skater learns is the layback spin, which was first performed by Cecilia College. But Cecilia wasn't naturally nimble. Informed by her coach that she was too stiff, she was sent to the London suburb of Brixton and a contortionist named Miss Lee.
Miss Lee had been in a circus. However, my mother thought it was a good idea.
Cecilia spent the summer of 1935 working with Miss Lee. Each morning, Miss Lee tied a rope around Cecilia's waist in order to stretch her back.
I can assure you it wasn't my idea of pleasure. Nevertheless, at the end of the summer, I was doing a backbend. And so, but each time I had a lesson, it would break all the little blood vessels at the top of my eyes. Every single day.
The layback spin, a maneuver that appears effortless. Only skaters understand the time and tenacity needed to perfect even the simplest move.
You see this performer or athlete, and it all looks very glamorous. But there's a lot of hard work that goes with that, and a lot of things that go on everywhere, inside your head, inside your stomach, you know, that we hide. Oh, it finds its way out in various ways. I ended up with a bleeding ulcer about 2 years after the Olympics. Really, there was a code of conduct, the unwritten rules. Certainly, you had to behave as a lady. You weren't allowed, weren't supposed to swear and kick the ice and throw temper tantrums.
There's a feeling of having to be perfect. Sometimes not even the skating. They can tell you, that costume doesn't quite fit with the music. Maybe if you change the color or shorten it. If you're a swimmer, nobody's picking on what you look like or what your bathing suit looked like.
Some skaters loved the public adoration that the glamour of the sport provided. Others felt hindered by the gender stereotype.
I always considered myself an athlete. Listen, it hurt when you fell on the ice. But there was always that element of showtime. It's not a team sport. You're out there alone. There's no place to hide. You make a mistake and everybody sees it.
It was very much of a more formal and social world than it is today. It has to do with being an upright, presentable champion that everybody felt that they could look up to. These were skaters and people who were responsible, elegant, beautiful athletes, and they presented themselves in impeccable fashion, every one of them.
Looking good was important. But in the end, a pretty costume could only get you so far.
Well, I was always jealous of the other skaters that had more money and had prettier things, but I thought, well, I can't fix that. I'll never have that. But what I can do, I can be a better skater. I can have a prettier body. I can spin faster. I can jump higher. I can work harder. You need that. Inner guts, and you need that, strength of steel underneath all of it to make it look effortless. That's the part of the athlete in us, because our sport is about athletics, and it's also about art.
It's the dual nature of the sport that makes it so compelling. Only female skaters are expected to excel as athletes and embody each generation's ideal of a lady. To do both to perfection is to become a champion.
Figures were a discipline that started in England when you skated on little patches of ice.
Before figure skating fell in love with jumping, before the only measure of skating elite was time spent in the air, figure skating was about figures. Literally tracing shapes into the ice as smoothly and as accurately as possible. Figures originally comprised two-thirds of a competitor's score. The school figures were practiced ceaselessly, discussed, debated, judged, accurately or not, and cursed as many a freewheeling skater's downfall. What they never were was seen by the masses.
As far as audience, there was very, very little audience at all. For the free skating, sure, but for school figures, not much.
If free skating gave you the rush of unbridled movement, the figures were about as liberating as standing still. They were performed with the skate planted firmly on the ice, an etching made with gem cutter's precision by the edge of the blade.
You're alone with your thoughts, and you're competing against yourself. It's how you place your thoughts with your feet and how the two work together.
It took a lot of work, but the greatest pleasure in a figure skater's life is to do as close to perfect a figure as you can. And it's a thing of beauty.
When it's well done, there is no scratching and there is no crunching. It's just a whisper.
You had between 11 and sometimes 13 judges.
They'd be standing there like pillars.
So close, you can almost feel them breathing down the back of your neck.
My foot would just shake like this.
It's, it's a little bit nerve-wracking.
You had to have tremendous concentration to do a decent figure.
When you finished the school figure, you skated off, and they would go and examine all the tracings.
There are two edges. You skate on either one edge or the other. You don't skate on two. They're looking to see if you touch the other edge slightly, which will show in a double tracing on the ice.
They have to get right down on the ice, almost with a magnifying glass.
And they take scars or little brooms and brush the snow off. And then they'd walk the circles. And if one circle was 10 paces, then the next circle had to be 10 paces.
Also, it's the shape that you make it with, the delicacy.
And then they'd do the width of the circle, and that had to be 10 paces, and then it had to be lined up.
You get very nervous.
Each skater traced three distinct shapes with her right foot, then three more with her left. The compulsory figure scores awarded by each judge were added together to yield a total. Judging skating is a subjective exercise. No one crosses a finish line or races against the clock. But the figures, those minute tracings, all but performed in secret, were particularly subject to judges' manipulation.
Judges certainly had their favorites, there's no doubt about it. Whether it was a question of countries or not, I don't know. But I know that certain judges disliked certain people.
There was great discrepancy on what is more or what should be more important. It was never written in a rule book that, you know, it's better to have round circles and traced patterns than clean turns.
I think that figures were used for, you know, a certain reason, and it was the one way it was easy to manipulate the sport.
Well, the coaches, what do they know? They do not know. I was supervising for, I get a little vehement at this point, I supervised for 30 years the performance of judges doing figures. And I reviewed those results year after year after year, and invariably, the judge was better doing the figures than they were the free skating.
In the first part of the century, judging was done in secret. It was said that a judge's best tool was his eraser. In both figures and free skating, a judge could award a high score for one skater, then see someone better and change his mind. After 1936, judges were forced to display their marks in open judging. The skaters could see them, and the audience could too.
There was no kiss and cry in those days. It was outdoors, and you hoped it wasn't snowing or raining. We had nine judges, and they would hold the marks up the old-fashioned way, and that's how you'd see.
Holding up those marks out in the open put the judges on the spot.
Well, the judge is out there to do a job, and his job there is to be fair and equal to the skaters, and the best person wins. Use all your knowledge of the rule book and your experience. Try to get the people in the right order that you want them to come. That's tremendous pressure. I've been out there in the cold, and the sweat's been pouring right off my forehead.
Even when the judging was beyond reproach, which will always be debated in figure skating, the figures were weighted so heavily that the best free skater often didn't win. Nowhere was that more obvious than in the 1971 World Championships in Lyon, France.
There was a big upset in 1971 between Trixie Shuba, who was a brilliant figure skater.
Her size and her weight was an asset because she was steady as a rock, and the line on the ice was absolutely perfect.
and Janet Lynn, who was a brilliant free skater.
I really idolized Janet Lynn. She was athletic and she was graceful and fluid and magical, I thought.
In those days, there was no short program. And as usual, Trixie had such a commanding lead after the figures.
Janet was not a good figure skater, never was.
Well, there was a lot of pressure for her to improve her figures because everyone loved what she was doing in free skating. And they wanted to see her do well on an international level.
Trixie went out there, large, elegant, statuesque in her own way, and skated her program with a wristwatch on, and did all the elements that she did, and everything was very nicely done. Then Janet came out.
She skated for some other reason, giving herself up to the movement that other people have never been able to do.
It was magic and it was beautiful, and people fell in love with her and they melted at her feet. But Janet couldn't possibly have caught Trixie.
I do remember Janet skating brilliantly and not winning a medal. And the French people were shouting her name. I mean, the French were really outraged that Janet didn't win a medal. And Pierre Brunet sort of motioned her to go stand at the side and kind of take a bow.
When she wasn't on the podium, the people in the building, and I think the people around the world, just didn't get it. And I think that was the real start of a change in figure skating and the way it's judged and the way it's perceived and the way television covers it.
In 1973, the short program was introduced, and figures were devalued to 30% of a skater's score. At the 1990 World Championships, figures were skated in competition for the last time.
It's a disaster that figures are being taken away. It really is. It really is.
It's a tedious thing, but it teaches tremendous self-discipline. I think that helped a lot because figure skating really is a sport based on discipline.
Michelle Kwan doesn't know, and Tara Lipinski, they don't know what school figures are. It's incredible to me.
The transformation in figure skating was sparked 5 decades earlier when Sonia first expressed her personality and charm on the ice. Janet Lynn took that expression one step further. She pushed the free skating into an art, an expression of feeling, a performance that connects the audience to the athlete in a way that no other sport can. As a sport, figure skating never looked back.
From the time I was 9 or 10, I definitely wanted to be Olympic champion. And if you can't dream at that age, I mean, when can you dream?
By the time Janet Lynn competed in Lyon, the American tradition of excellence in the sport had been well established. Teresa Weld, Beatrix Lagren, and Maribel Vincent Owen had all won bronze or silver medals in skating's early years, but no American lady had won a world or Olympic gold medal. Tenley Albright changed all that, but she had to fight to do it. At age 9, she contracted polio.
I was holding my 6-week-old cousin in my arms when I first got polio, and I remember very clearly my arms going weak and saying to my mother, would you please hold the baby? I'm afraid I'm going to drop her.
For 3 weeks, Tenley lay in a hospital bed, her right leg paralyzed.
I clearly remember that feeling of taking those first steps, having my feet on that cold floor, and having the doctors in their white coats just sort of standing back quietly and no one was holding me. No one knew what caused polio, where it came from, really how it spread or what to do about it. My parents thought, well, I had liked to skate, so why not that? Because I could stay away from children, not scare them.
During the long months of Tenley's recovery, skating became more than a rehabilitation. It became her passion. Before long, she wasn't just a recovering polio patient, but a champion skater who spent 1 month each year training in Lake Placid. By 1953, 8 years after the first step, Tenley was the best in the world.
And now what are you going to do for your encore?
Well, first of all, I don't think it's very fair that you don't have skates on this evening.
It's much fairer to me not to have them on, but I got little spikes in my shoes.
Starting in 1953, Carol Heiss was America's second best skater. And she was always chasing Tenley Albright. 4 years younger, Carol had never beaten Tenley. The fact that these two skaters came from such different backgrounds, proper Bostonian and working class New Yorker, made the rivalry even richer.
We really only saw each other at competitions, so we never really got a chance to know each other well.
My parents were immigrants from Germany. My mother wasn't socially prominent. My dad was a baker. We didn't have much money. So it was rather unique then. As I made the world team, it was our neighbors in Ozone Park that helped to buy me a pair of skates for Christmas that year. And it was the Skating Club of New York members that got together and bought my mother her ticket and my airline ticket to go to the World Championships in Davos, Switzerland.
For the first time in history, at the 1956 Olympics at Cortina d'Ampezzo, the U.S. ladies were favored to win gold and silver.
Cortina was freezing. And the costumes were all chiffon or lightweight, and there was just no way you could keep warm and stay warm.
Tenley had a serious problem in Cortina. Only days before the competition, she'd fallen backward and pierced her right ankle with the blade of her left boot. She trained in Cortina in pain.
It did hurt. It hurt every minute. But the thing that really made such a difference to me was the whole audience started humming my music. When you're making yourself do something, it's one thing, but when that was over, how do I get off the ice? I have to figure out a way that is not going to show the problem.
In a courageous performance, Tenley won America's first Olympic gold medal in ladies' figure skating. To her right, again, stood Carol Heiss. Only 2 weeks later, the generation turned. As the reigning Olympic and defending world champion, Tenley lost the world title. This time, Carol triumphed.
It took close to 3.5 hours before they said, "You are definitely the champion." My mother just said, "That's wonderful, honey. Congratulations. Well done. Now can we go back to the hotel?" And that's when I realized that she was seriously ill. She was bedridden for 9.5 months. She never really got out of bed and just ended up dying of cancer. And I felt sorry for Tenley, but that championship probably means about as much to me as winning the Olympic gold medal. It was the only time my mother saw me be world champion.
In 1956, Tenley retired. In 1960, Carol won her own Olympic gold medal in Squaw Valley. Americans had become the sport's dominant force. A new champion was emerging, Laurence Owen. Laurence was coached by her mother, Olympic medalist Maribel Vincent Owen.
Laurence was real long-legged, real short, free-looking hair. She was very commanding out there because of her height. Every move she did looked huge.
In 1961, Laurence was a high school senior headed for Radcliffe when she won the U.S. National Championship.
is a very happy young lady, Laurence Owen, our national ladies champion. Congratulations to you.
Oh, well, thank you, Mr. Palmer. Golly, I feel terrific right now.
This daughter of an Olympian graced the cover of Sports Illustrated on February 13th, 1961. The next day, she and the other 17 members of the American team boarded a Sabena airplane at Idlewild Airport, bound eventually for the 1961 World Championships in Prague. Having just taken the American and North American titles, young Laurence Owen was the U.S. hope and the favorite to win at Worlds.
It was an American tragedy.
It was the most devastating aviation disaster in the history of sports. The past, present, and future of American figure skating perished together on February 15, 1961, in a wooded area near Brussels. No official explanation has ever been given. The plane tried to land, but pulled up steeply a half mile from the runway. Three times the plane traced a circle in the sky before its nose lurched upward and the engine stalled. It was demolished on impact. There were no survivors.
Well, from what we can gather and from the information that was available, that they were huddled together and that they were holding on to one another when their bodies were found, so that they knew ahead of time that the plane was going down.
Oh, so many people, all the leaders in the sport.
My brother-in-law called me in California at about 2:30 in the morning, and David said, they're all gone. And he was just sobbing. And I said, David, what do you mean? He said, all the skaters. He said, the plane taking them into Brussels has crashed.
It took me a long time to grasp that they're gone, they're dead. And that's hard for any kid. My coach was killed on that plane crash. He was a young, very handsome man, Bill Kipp.
Though the rest of the competitors had arrived in Prague, the event was canceled, while the skating world grieved. Oscar Johnson, one of the owners of the Ice Capades, knew what the world had lost in Laurence Owen. She had that certain something we look all over the world for and rarely find, he said. She could have become the greatest performer on ice the world has ever known. Laurence, her mother Maribel Vincent Owen, her sister Maribel, and the other 31 members of the American delegation were all gone. No one will ever know what they could have accomplished. In her junior year, Laurence wrote this poem called Awakening. Softly, the spring comes creeping o'er the tired land. All men awake, refreshed. They rise to greet the world with joy, and birds sing, and all becomes newborn. Gloom is but a shadow of the night, long past. Hope is the light, the radiance.
There was an enormous gap in the entire ranks of skating. When 1962 came around, the skaters who earned their berth on the team were more inexperienced than any skaters had been probably in the last quarter century prior to that. It did not begin to emerge from this vacuum until 1964, when Peggy Fleming won the national championship. But even at that time, she was not an outstanding, you know, tour de force of skating.
That was the first time I ever competed at that senior level. It was like a total shock to me, my coach, my parents, and I think the skating world. but it qualified me for the Olympic team in 64, which also shocked us again. I didn't have a passport, didn't have a warm coat. It was very exciting, very big-eyed time for me.
Suffering from the flu, the 16-year-old Peggy skated in her first Olympics. She finished sixth.
After the Olympics in 64, the thought crossed my mind that I think I could do this. I think I could beat those people. Because I didn't like how they were skating. A Sjoukje Dijkstra won in 64. And she was such a muscular skater and really a big woman, very strong. She could do the jumps, but she was not graceful. And I go, well, I don't like that at all.
I think Peggy was the first real ballerina to come onto the ice looking so frail and then jumping so high, being so athletic and looking like just a little butterfly, but really a steel butterfly.
She was an elegant and gentle skater. She had wonderful technique and wonderful ability, and she had beautiful line. And most important of all, she had a mother.
I could have never have done what I did without her and without the encouragement of my dad, too. It's just amazing that I got where I got with the amount of money we had. My dad would come to the rink and make the ice. My mother made all my dresses. She had a tendency to like finish the costume moments before we would leave, which would my anxiety level would like go way up. Mom, please finish my dress before I have to go on the ice. Don't be sewing in the dressing room as I'm walking out to a competition.
When Americans watched Peggy Fleming win the only U.S. gold medal in the 68 Winter Olympics in Grenoble, France, they were not only witnessing the achievement of a single athlete, but America's rebirth in the sport, a mere 7 years after the tragedy.
I knew I could never live up to Peggy Fleming. I just knew it. She was just a lady. I was a kid. I was a little punk kid. While I appreciated her, I just thought, well, I gotta go completely the other direction.
She was right out front with her skating. It was clean, it was honest, it was open. It was like all American as apple pie.
Thank you very much.
It was flawless. Was there any imperfections that you thought of? What was it?
I have a combination that I didn't do. There were two double axels instead of the one, and I only did one.
Well, you're free to do that. That's why it's called free skating,
right.
And everything else was really absolutely perfection.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dorothy.
Thank you. I'm so relieved.
She was a beautiful, beautiful spinner, and she was the girl that every boy in America was in love with.
Dorothy was 17 when she won her first national championship, and before long, she became America's girl next door. She squinted when she tried to read her scores, and girls all over America were asking for the Hamill wedge.
The one comment I get more than anything today was, I had that haircut, or my mother made me have that haircut, or my wife used to have that haircut. I would get letters from hairdressers saying, please change your haircut, please. I'm just tired of cutting it.
With her father by her side, Dorothy was so immersed in skating on her way to the 1976 Olympics that the outside world rarely affected her. When Time magazine published its Olympic issue with her face on the cover, she wasn't even aware of it.
My world was, you know, I'd get up at 4 a.m. and I would skate 6 or 7 hours a day. I had to squeeze in school. You know, to be an amateur, you could not have a job. We were truly amateur athletes, but we were competing because we loved our sport.
Dorothy had no idea how many Americans were rooting for her success.
The night before I competed at the Olympics, they delivered a stack of telegrams. And I didn't know who these people were. They were just well-wishers. That's when I started to realize, you know, the power of television and the importance of the Olympic Games. And all of a sudden, I felt this gigantic pressure. Well, I see a very naive child. It was a great, great moment.
Dorothy Hamill with
us. That seemed as though it was my education and sort of the backbone of everything that I would ever do. It was a great sense of relief of certainly being very proud to be an American, I mean, because that was really what it was all about at that point.
What had started 7 decades before as an enthusiasm had matured into a sport that enraptures millions. The growing pains, the joy, the freedom and charm had become history, and the memories mere reflections on ice. To tear a page from this diary of ladies' figure skating is to know what it was like when perfection was expected, both on and off the ice. And when winning an Olympic medal for your country was both the grandest and the greatest of achievements. The world changes, of course, and sport inevitably evolves with it. But we can return to a time when figure skating was a sport for ladies. When a lady could lace up a pair of skates, step out into a brisk morning breeze, and for a few minutes at least, truly be free. This has been a presentation of HBO Sports, the network of champions.